Welcome. Welcome back to our Celtic services. We've had a little break over the summer, but we are back again now and we'll hopefully be doing these every month. I want to remind you that you can access the bulletin online so that you can follow along with all that we're doing here tonight. So let us begin as we pray together. Holy God, in the silence of this moment, call us by name. Fill our weary spirits and deepen our faith. Give us new eyes to see your blessings all around. For you are the giver of peace, the source of joy, and a whisper of love in the stillness. Amen.
Please pray with me. Lord God, as we prepare to hear your word, help us to reject those barriers that keep us from truly receiving it. Free us from the arrogance that causes us to look at the faults of others while ignoring our own. Broaden our understanding of justice that our lives might be filled with your holiness. Remove every distraction and clear our thought through your spirit. We pray in the name of Jesus, who is our strength and joy. Amen.
Reading this evening comes from James chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us make many mistakes. Anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect and able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide their whole bodies. Or look at ships. Though they are so large that it takes strong winds to drive them, yet they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among our members as a world of iniquity. It stains the whole body, sets on fire the cycle of nature, and is itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species. But no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it, we bless the Lord and Father, and with it, we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. Thanks be to God. You pray with me. Gracious God, we ask now that you will help us put aside the distractions of this world, that as we have heard your word, that we can now listen to the way you're speaking to each of us this night. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. I'm going to share with you a story that maybe you've heard before, a story about a little boy, a young boy, who unfortunately had a very bad temper, that when he got frustrated or things didn't go his way, he would just get very angry and start shouting and yelling and saying angry words to anyone and everyone. So one day his father took him out into the backyard to the back fence, and he gave them a bowl with nails in it and a hammer. And he told his son, he said, every time you lose your temper and you're angry with your words, I want you to nail a hammer into the fence. And so it began. Well, by the end of the first day, there were already many nails hammered into the fence. And so the days went by. However, gradually, as time went by, less nails got hammered in each day, because the little boy began to figure out that it was more work to hammer the nails into the fence than to try to control his temper and his angry words. Well, gradually, time went by, and the day came when he went to his father and he said, I didn't have to hammer any nails in today. So his father was very proud, and he said, I'm proud of you, son. So now, every day that you keep your temper and that you don't have angry words, you can pull out a nail from the fence. And so days began, and each day that the boy did not lose his temper and did not have angry words for people, he was able to pull out a nail. Well, time went by until finally the day came when the boy pulled out the very last nail in the fence. And he went to his father and he said, "I've pulled out all the nails." And his father said, "I'm very proud of you for learning how to control your temper and not always lash out with angry words." But he said to his son, "Now I want you to look at the fence and tell me, what do you see?" So his son said, "I see lots of holes in the fence." And his father said, "Yes, that even though you have pulled out the nails, the fence will never be the same because of all the holes." And he said, "It's like that. If we get a wound, if we stab ourselves with a knife, the knife would come out and the wound would be healed, but there'd be a scar there, that it's not the same. Even when we say angry words to somebody or we put them down, we are basically wounding them. And even if we say we're sorry, there is still something that lasts and can make them feel sad for a long time." He wanted his son to remember the lesson that he had learned about hammering the nails in the fence and how we can hurt people, not just physically, but by the words that we say. Do you remember ever being a child and maybe playing with other kids and other kids that gonna say they're gonna hurt you, but the little rhyme that people would say, kids would say, is, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me." Sounds good as a child, but actually as we grow old, we discover how untrue that statement is, because words can be very hurtful. It seems that, to me, right now we're living in this age that we are bombarded all around by people saying negative, angry, hateful words. And unfortunately, I think because we keep hearing it and hearing it, sometimes we find when we get frustrated, we're tempted to do the same thing. And maybe we should worry about our children and what example they are seeing and hearing. The writer of the book of James was concerned even back then about lack of tongue control. He began even in the first chapter of his book. He writes this: "You must understand this, my beloved, that everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. If any think that they are religious and do not bridle their tongues but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless." James was trying to tell the people then, and I think speaks to us today, that when we let our tongues get out of control with angry, harsh, bitter, hurtful words, that we are not doing what God wants us to do. We are not living the kind of life that we are called to live as Christians. James expands on this topic in the passage that I just read in the third chapter. He gives us some images. He talks about the fact that we can control a horse because we have a bit in its mouth, which is only a small thing. We are able to control the whole body. The rider can control the whole body, but that small bit. He also mentions that rudders on big ships, he said big ships that the big winds can blow. Now I realize that our ships are not typically blown by wind these days, but back then they were. But he said it's the small piece, the small rudder on the ship that allows the pilot of the ship, the captain of the ship, to direct the ship the way he wants. But James then goes on to say that the tongue, which is a small part of our body, can have great power over us, because very often we don't control it. We don't put a bit on it or keep it under control. James then talks about wildfires, and he says how easily a small spark can set a wildfire, so set a blaze. Now, we should know a lot about that, because in so many places we've been hearing there have been wildfires. And sometimes wildfires are started maybe by a dropped match, a little thing that can set a blaze, a forest, or an untended campfire. So many things can start a huge blaze. And that's the image that James is using to tell us that maybe a few little angry, harsh, bitter words can set a blaze of angry, harsh, bitter words, that it's like a roller coaster. Things keep going on and on and on. And our tongue becomes that we can't control it, that becomes the norm of how we start talking to each other. James, in the passage, he lamented that every creature can be tamed by humans, but no one can tame the tongue. And the saddest of all, he says, is that with it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. And he says, my brothers and sisters, this ought not to be so. I would think we would agree with that we shouldn't be blessing and cursing from the same mouth, both blessing God and blessing and cursing those who are made in the likeness of God. Pastor Neil has been doing a sermon series called Reckless Love, and been talking about what Jesus called the greatest, the first commandment, to love God and to love our neighbors. And during it, we've talked about how loving neighbors can be a way that we love God, that we grow in our love for God. So if loving our neighbors is a way that we grow in our love for God and grow closer to God, what does that say when we put down other people, when we hate other people or despise other people? What does that do to our relationship with God? It probably hurts our relationship, because we are turning away from the way God wants us to live, in love and kindness with one another. It causes God's heart to break, I would think. However, the good news for us is that God forgives us, that God knows that we fall short, but God is full of grace and mercy, and God is continually seeking a good relationship with us. So when we turn and repent and ask for God's forgiveness, it is always there and ready for us. In the book of Ephesians, it says, let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. Let our words be for building up, not tearing down, not putting down, not belittling all the negative things that we can hear or even fall into ourselves. So maybe in this time of dissension and division and anger and hatred, we need to turn to God. We need to turn to God in prayer to help us be the people that are more intent on being the people that God wants us to be the people of love and kindness, to be God's people who build up instead of tearing down. So I encourage you to let our daily prayer be together, create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Amen.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Forgive us, gracious God, for our self-indulgent behaviors. Forgive us when we spread cruelty instead of love. Forgive us when we bring strife and jealousy into relationships that yearn for peace and understanding. Forgive us when our anger brings dissensions and division. Fill us with your Spirit that we might bring love and joy into our relationships, peace and patience into your world, kindness and generosity into our community, faithfulness and strength into your church, gentleness and self-control into our daily lives. Amen.
You may have recognized that tune as the tune that we use when we sing the prayer of St. Francis. It's the most beautiful prayer that helps us when we need to feel that we are offering ourselves to God to be instruments of peace. Let us pray that prayer together. Hear these words. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. And now may the blessings of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit keep, guard, and guide you now and always. Amen.